Change your heart. Lord, change our heart. You're living in a lawful way. Be mindful of what you say. Be sincere when you pray. Today could be your last day. Bear each other no malice. Greed and faith can coexist in the same heart.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala ashrafi mursaleen. Nabina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Welcome to another episode of the Gems of the Heart, where we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to purify our hearts with the names and attributes of Allah, with the belief in Allah, with the belief in general in the unseen, with acts of worship, with manners, with everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, with the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. This is how to purify our hearts. If people try to purify their hearts and to fill their hearts with all kinds of goodness, there is no way to do that unless it's in the Quran or in the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. The purest of all hearts is the heart of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And there's no way anyone would purify his heart unless he truly followed the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And the more the person follows the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, the more that he would have a pure heart. And as mentioned before many, many times, that what is the significance of having a pure heart? Why is it important to purify our hearts and to have a sound heart? The importance of it comes from the point that for anyone to enter the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they have to have a pure heart. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about Ibrahim alayhi salam when he made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلَا تُخْزِنِي يَوْمَ يُبْعَثُونَ يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. Do not disgrace me in the day of resurrection, in the day when there is no wealth nor offsprings will avail and benefit the person except the one that comes with a sound heart. No one will be allowed to enter Jannah with the slightest amount of impurity in the heart. And that's why this is the time to purify our hearts. And that's why the purification of the hearts with the proper belief, with the acts of worship, with repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from sins. Impurities are kufr, disbelief, shirk, associating partners with Allah, diseases done by the heart, sins done by the heart, sins done by one's speech, by one's actions. So to be steadfast and to be obedient to Allah, and even if we do that, we cannot perfect ourselves because we're human beings. So to add to it that we're constantly repenting to Allah. That's how the purification of the hearts becomes in place when a person is dedicated, determined, seeking help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be steadfast and learning how to be steadfast upon the truth while constantly returning to Allah and repenting to Allah to keep that purification of one's heart and one's soul. We've been talking about the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for many episodes. And we talked about the two names or so in the Quran are joined together in many places in the Quran. Almost every time a name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioned in the Quran, it's associated with another name of Allah. So another name of Allah is mentioned, and that's why many of the verses of the Quran ends with two of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we talked about that last time. This time also, inshallah ta'ala, as a continuation to reflect upon the Quran, and if the benefit that we get from this, that the Quran will need to spend more time to reflect upon its meanings and to benefit from it. And nobody can really find an end to this because it's the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing is the like of it. But we have to be careful. When it comes to reflection upon the meanings of the Quran, it has to be based on ilm, based on knowledge. And that's why the ulama, they make the part of reflecting upon the verses of the Quran comes after the tafsir. Tafsir comes first. So understanding the meanings of the verses comes first because that has its principles and ways of making the tafsir with the Quran, with the sunnah, with the statements of the sahaba and so on. And then the reflecting part, it has to come from also a person of knowledge based on the proper understanding of the tafsir or the explanation of the Quran. So when we talk about these names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, we need to understand the meanings of it and how can that affect us in our practical way of doing things and to reflect more even when there are two of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are mentioned together. As the ulama, they mentioned, each name has its meanings and its benefits and the significance of it and so on. And then the two names together, they add more meanings and not just one name and the other. And that's why there is, you would find some verses ends with Al-Azeez Al-Hakeem. Some verses ends with Al-Azeez Al-Hamid or Al-Azeez Al-Aleem or Al-Azeez Al-Rahim. So is there a difference or it's all the same meaning? Of course it's not the same meaning. And the significance of mentioning Al-Hakeem versus Al-Hamid versus Al-Aleem with Al-Azeez, it adds more meanings to it. So let's look, inshallah ta'ala, briefly again in this episode with the two names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that are the most repeated together in the Quran, which is Al-Aziz Al-Hakim. Al-Aziz Al-Hakim mentioned many times in the Quran. Sometimes it's Al-Aziz Al-Hakim like this, and sometimes it's Aziz Al-Hakim without an alif lam. And the number of the verses that talks about or mention both like this are 42 verses in the Quran that has Al-Aziz Al-Hakim or Aziz Al-Hakim. And to be more specific, 29 verses of the Quran talks about Al-Aziz Al-Hakim and 13 has Aziz Al-Hakim. Numbers is of no significance for us to make assumptions as a result of the numbers like some people do. They start talking about the numbers or the verses and that means this and that means that. We have to stay away from that. That's not something that the early generations of Islam, they talked about. But if it's mentioned, sometimes you would mention number or numbers of verses as a way of, a pleasant meaning to be mentioned. There is no harm. But this is not something for a person to go beyond what the tafsir of the verses or trying to explain it in according to one's desire. This is something that we have to stay away from, of course. So when we look at some of these examples of these two names together, first of all, we talked about Al-Aziz and we talked about Al-Hakim, two names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Aziz means the Almighty, the one that has the power and the means to execute, to create, to do whatever he will, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nobody can oppose Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because he is Al-Aziz, so the Almighty, the most powerful, the one, the most honored, and so on. Nobody can say anything because, again, it doesn't need much for a person to be convinced about this. We're talking about Al-Khaliq, the creator of the heavens and the earth and the human beings, versus the human beings, those who are created by Allah, or other than Allah, that are created by Allah. So how can a creation, that means they are created by Allah, would overpower the creator of the heavens and the earth? They are in need of the creator in every breath that they take. So how can they have a say, or how can they have any might and power if it's not by the permission of Allah? So this is a very obvious thing for the believers. That's why when a person witnesses in himself that he has some power, some means of doing things, the believers, they don't become ignorant and forgetful that they're only looking at their own power and ways of doing things. They cannot detach from this that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that created that in them. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, He can take that away from them. So therefore, their actions will be accordingly. And there's a major difference between someone forgetful in this life, he only sees his power and ability and might and so on, and someone else, he sees that this is a creation of Allah. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, He can deprive the person from this power. And everything is by the power of Allah, everything by the will of Allah. That second person, he will be that state of humbleness. He would fulfill the rights of things and he would be a righteous person. The first one, he will become ignorant. Someone that is doing criminal acts, transgressing the limits, being forgetful, not worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the purpose of our life. So Al-Aziz, the one that has the power that nobody can defeat him. So when someone asks, but there are the disbelievers and the sinners and things like this, they do things against the deen of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the people to worship him, and these people, they do the opposite. And they do not worship Allah, and they oppose those who worship of Allah. So how can then we understand the name of Al-Aziz? Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not able to punish them or to bring them to the justice of Allah? Of course Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Aziz. But that's why Al-Hakim comes with it. That means he's the most wise. So don't think of the izzah of Allah or the power of Allah the way that you think about your own self as a human being. You as a human being, you're deficient. You might have some power in doing things, but many times it's not with wisdom. And the wisdom of Allah, nothing is the like of it. So the believers, they rely upon Allah. So when something like this, why there is disbelief, why there is evil and so on, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most wise. And if He subhanahu wa ta'ala will, He can destroy everything that is against the orders of Allah, because He's Al-Azeez. But that doesn't happen on the face of earth. It's the way that Allah created the way on the land, on the earth is in such a way that this doesn't happen. So for the believers, they need to read the Qur'an. For human beings, they need to read the Qur'an and to embrace this truth, to see the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth. That's one of the benefits when these two names and other names are together. So when we look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the name Al-Aziz, He's the Almighty. Nobody can oppose the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's how we have to believe in it this way. So when someone asks, can Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring the justice on the face of earth immediately? Definitely, no doubt. But why this is delayed, according to how the human beings, they understand things, we have to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most wise. Things happen by the wisdom of Allah, not according to what human beings they desire. For great reason. And these reasons is to establish the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the earth for. To establish the ubudiyyah, the worship of Allah. And that read the Qur'an, you would find the matter explained clearly. So when we look again into Al-Aziz Al-Hakeem in the Qur'an and how many times it's mentioned, and we don't have the time, of course, to go through all of the verses in the Qur'an that talks about these two names mentioned together. But we would find many different verses in the Qur'an that talks about the power of Allah and the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of which, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has the power to send messengers of Allah. Those who deny the belief in the messengers of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that sent them. So when people, they deny this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is able to do all things. So He sent messengers of Allah. How can a human being reveal to him from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the angels and so on? This is all by the power of Allah. And He's the most wise. He could have sent someone else. He could have sent angels. He could have sent, things for each individual. But He sent messengers. So leave it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam when it's mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah. رَبَّنَا وَبَعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ Ibrahim alayhi salam, and that's how the prophets alayhi salam, they understand the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Oh Allah, our Lord, send to them among them a messenger from among them, recite unto them the ayat of Allah and teaching them the book and the wisdom and to purify them. إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ Indeed, you are the Almighty, the Most Wise. In sending the messenger, of knowing who fits and who befits this position. And He subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty, the one that would fulfill whatever He decreed subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He subhanahu wa ta'ala has the wisdom of who to be purified and who's not, and who's to be chosen to be the messenger or not. When the disbelievers, they suggested, why this messenger? Why not someone else? It's not up to them. It's by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it's based on the power of Allah and the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so on. We read in the Qur'an, in many places in the Qur'an, stories in the Qur'an. And these stories in the Qur'an, they are mentioned not like in any other book or any other ways that people narrate stories. It's mentioned in the Qur'an for a reason, for the reciter of the Qur'an to benefit from it. And one of which is for a person to see the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that there is no one worthy of worship except Allah. The stories in the Qur'an are mentioned for people to believe in Allah. For people to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone and to be obedient to Allah, to get to see the ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth that is based on the wisdom, on the power of Allah. Nothing happens without the power of Allah. Everything is by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He's the most wise. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ هَذَا لَهُوَ الْقَصَصُ الْحَقِّ إِنَّ هَذَا لَهُوَ الْقَصَصُ الْحَقِّ وَمَا مِنْ إِلَهٍ إِلَّا اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَهُ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ Which means that is indeed, this is the true stories, Al-Qasas Al-Haq, after mentioning the stories in Surah Ali Imran and the story of Isa, Jesus the son of Mary, this is the true story. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that narrates this. وَمَا مِنْ إِلَهٍ إِلَّا اللَّهِ And there's no one worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أن الله سبحانه وتعالى is indeed لهو العزيز الحكيم. By Allah, definitely, He is the Almighty and He is the Most Wise, سبحانه وتعالى. So, calling the people of the book to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to leave the matter to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He's the one that created Isa, Jesus, the son of Mary, without a father. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Almighty. He's able to do so. And it doesn't have to be that people will interpret it their own ways. It is sufficient enough to know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created him this way. As He created Adam without a father and a mother, He created Jesus, the son of Mary, without a father. And He's the Most Wise. He created him this way for a great wisdom, one of which is to test the human beings and things that we do not know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Most Wise. And that's why even with the same two names are mentioned in Surah Al-Ma'idah with regards to the people of the book, towards the end of Surah Al-Ma'idah, when Isa alayhi salam would make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the Prophet would say the same dua with regards to his ummah in the salah at night and repeat this dua over and over again. إِن تُعَذِّبُهُمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ عِبَادُكَ وَإِن تَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ فَإِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. إِن تُعَذِّبُهُمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ عِبَادُكَ. If you punish them, they are your slaves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Almighty. He punishes whoever He wills. Nobody is to question Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But this punishment of Allah is by the wisdom of Allah. وَإِن تَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ. And if you forgive them, He did not say in this context, فَإِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ, that indeed you are the most forgiver, the most merciful. He said, if you forgive them, you are indeed Al-Azeez Al-Hakeem, the Almighty, the Most Wise. As we know that the names of Allah that are mentioned at the end of the verses are related to the subject of the verse or the verses before it. So, and that's what, you know, the people of knowledge, when they make the tafsir of the ayat, you know, some, you know, when they talk about why these two names are mentioned in this verse, because the verse says this. So that's why there is a, you know, a meaning here that is related to these two names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that has its effect, you know, on the reciter of the Quran. So Isa alayhi salam, when he's making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or saying to Allah that if you punish them, that they are your slaves, but if you forgive them, you are the Almighty, the Most Wise, because he knew that there is no forgiveness in the Day of Judgment for those who associate partners with Allah. So that's why he says, you are the Almighty, the Most Wise. Did not say that you are the Most Forgiver, the Most Merciful, even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Most Forgiver. But the context of it, it's not a context of forgiveness. It's a context of justice of Allah and the punishment of Allah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty, the Most Wise. We can go on and on with the verses. If we go through the verses, again, there are 42 verses in the Quran. But we need to, again, as the benefit mentioned earlier, we need to reflect upon these meanings and to fill our hearts with relying upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and not to really think that why this ruling is this. Sometimes people, they think, why this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordained upon the believers to observe, right? Why, for example, you know, when out of ignorance or lack of knowledge, or the enemies of Allah, when they say, why the qiwama is in the hands of the men? Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the men in charge of the women in the household? Even though they don't ask that same question when they're working in a place and they have a boss and he has authority over them, or when they live in a country and there's a system in authority or a person in authority, nobody questioned that because they know that how human beings they live on the face of earth, they have to have a form of authority, otherwise chaos becomes in charge and people would just, you know, be shed of blood and all kinds of evil things happens and no security. So someone has to be in charge. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the men in charge, and that's a responsibility comes with it. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in the Quran, as he said, وَلِلْرِجَالِ عَلَيْهِنَّ دَرَجَةً وَاللَّهُ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. That when it talks about the men and women, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that the men, they have a level above the women, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Aziz, the Almighty, so that the men do not think that they can, you know, transgress as a result of this or cause harm. And to know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Hakeem also, that He subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Most Wise, with that ruling, that He gave the men to be in charge in this, because He is the Most Wise, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He made them the one to have the authority or the talaq or the divorce in their hands, and that's by the wisdom of Allah. People can talk about the wisdom of Allah in this. how men are different than women and so on. But for the believers, it's sufficient to know that this is from Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His rulings does not come like this, how human beings they think. When we look at human beings and how they establish laws, that's an amazing one. And that's something that probably people will have even PhDs, theses and books, research based on this history. How human beings, they the stages that they go through in legislating things, and how they change rapidly, but how they legislate, it's all circumstantial. That means, you know, an accident happens. So there was no law before that kind of perfected that weakness. So major thing happens, so then they would legislate laws to prevent the like of these accidents to happen again, right? Laws that governs the way that people deal with racism, for example. When there is laws established and it allows injustices to a certain race when people are living together. So when people see this, and maybe or sometimes or oftentimes, they wait for a major incident to happen. And then they all be or realize, oh, there's a fault here that we need to fix. So they start legislating so that they can fix this issue. But because they're human beings and they're deficient, maybe they would fix one thing and they cause restrictions to the freedom of the people, for example, on the other hand, or something else, because they're human beings. They're weak and deficient. But if they refer the matter to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all kinds of goodness they would see, justice and mercy. Because this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's why human beings, they keep on trying and trial errors and they keep on being confused in many things, and things are not getting better, it's getting worse the way they would legislate for themselves, unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will otherwise. So we continue inshallah ta'ala with that, with the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Aziz Al-Hakeem, after the break. So stay with us inshallah.
Really come to understand that to be a Muslim, to be someone who says they've surrendered and submitted to the will of God, is to be in harmony with everything around you and to be a benefit to everyone.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our Creator, He gave us a life plan. He told us what to do. He gave us, you know, goals and what He expects from us.
It has roots in Islam, because the first man who was created, Adam, he was neither a Jew or a Christian, but he submitted himself to God. Abraham, he didn't submit to anyone in creation. He didn't even hear in any of these religions. But when he was told to do what? Submit to the will of God, that's Islam.
Attached to his preconceived notions. Yes. And if he looks with an objective eye and an open heart, he'll see it. Unless Allah, for some reason, has something over his eyes because of something that we don't know is in his heart.
You had, from 1980 to 2005, you had the FBI data report showing that, now from all these years, that only 6% had any links to Islam. 94% were people who had nothing to do with Islam.
Welcome back. And we're talking about the two names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Aziz Al-Hakim. And as a way to reflect more into the verses of the Quran that talks about this, and we need to really seek guidance from Allah in the Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallam, but that is based on ilm or knowledge, not just based on anyone to take whatever they want from the Quran and the Sunnah. It requires for the person to learn the deen from the people of knowledge. This is a lineage. That it's such a beautiful lineage that goes all the way to the Prophet والسلام, and not just from text here and there, but rather to humble oneself, to learn the deen of Allah and to respect the people of knowledge with regards to this matter. Before the break, we were talking about how the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Aziz Al-Hakim, the Almighty, the Most Wise subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that would purify our hearts from some of the doubts that people might have with regards to some of the rulings of Allah. And as a matter of fact, human beings can never basically get to know all of the wisdom behind things because they are limited and deficient. And there's a level of submission that they need to submit themselves to the Creator of the heavens and the earth. But there are basic things that people would get to know living on the face of earth. But for example, as we talked about some of the rulings with regards to the relationship between men and women, and to remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Azeez Al-Hakeem. Also, Aziz Al-Hakeem is mentioned without the Alif and Lam in a verse that relates to this. You know, something that people accuse the religion of Islam, the disbelievers of course, accuse the religion of Islam of certain punishment, that this is barbaric or this is very cruel and things like this, like cutting the hands of the thief. First of all, this is a subject that this is not the time for us to explain it in details, but it has rules and regulations. It's not that anybody that steals anything that, you know, the rule is to cut their hands. Of course, this is by the people of authority. If they don't do it, then it is not for the individual ones, but even for the people of authority has a specific way to establish this. Not everything that gets stolen that the thief would get his hand cut off, but going just the concept of it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in the Quran. So when people find it as an ease in the 21st century, how can that be the case? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَالسَّارِقُ وَالسَّارِقَةُ فَقُطَعُوا أَيْدِيَهُمَا جَزَاءً بِمَا كَسَبَ نَكَالًا مِنَ اللَّهِ. And how the verse ends, وَاللَّهُ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. The ayah ends with, and Allah is the Almighty, the Most Wise. The stealing, وَالسَّارِقُ وَالسَّارِقَةُ, male and female, the stealing men and women, cut their hands, جَزَاءً بِمَا كَسَبَ, as a recompense of what they've earned. They did it to themselves. And this is a punishment from Allah for them. وَاللَّهُ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ, He's the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Most Wise. So the significance of both of these names together, even though as we see the next verse, so that people also, they take things out of context. فَمَنْ تَابَ مِنْ بَعْدِ ظُلْمِ وَأَصْلَحَ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ يَتُوبُ عَلَيْهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Whoever repents to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after they transgressed and they rectified, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept their repentance. And indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most forgiver, the most merciful. So all of that is mentioned, right? But Al-Aziz Al-Hakim or Aziz Al-Hakim is mentioned, the Almighty, the Most Wise. So when someone questions the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they need to understand that Allah is the Most Wise. That the punishment, as it's mentioned, it's for what reason? For that individual and for the benefit of the human beings. And if they don't apply the orders of Allah in the proper way again, you know, how is it to be applied? This is not what many people think. Not for anyone that steals. It has certain conditions to be fulfilled, right? So when this is the case, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most wise. And if people, they think that they are, wal'ayadu billah, wiser, they know what's best for them, you see how the reality of humanity, and how when one ruling like this from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is applied, it brings the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unto the people. Security for the people. It deters so many people, those who, you know, as human beings, some people are really criminals and they are into this. And many people, they basically in between of being righteous or being committing criminal acts. And they, many of them, they would commit the crimes because the system that they're in is not really tough on those who would commit crimes. So they, in some situations, the prison is much pleasant for them than to live in a rough environment. So the point here is to, just to make the long story short, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most wise. So there's a great wisdom behind it, whether we know it or whether we don't know it. And definitely what's best is for the person in the hereafter to return to the mercy of Allah. So this is something to reflect upon, that everything is by the might and the power of Allah. And if they think that they can escape their punishment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Aziz. He's the Almighty and He's the most wise subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many verses again like this in the Quran talks about Al-Aziz Al-Hakim, so that we always witness the power of Allah that brings what in the hearts of the people? Humbleness to Allah. To again, not to rely our own power, but to rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And at the same time, to always think and to believe that everything has a wisdom behind it, so that a person does not fall into or rush into thinking bad about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Because the reason why many people, they think bad about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because they don't know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His names and attributes. And they think that the actions of Allah are like the actions of the human beings. So they start thinking bad about Allah. So if a human being takes the eyes of someone, poke someone's eyes, this is evil from an action of the human being if he does this. So when people out of ignorance, when they see a child becomes blind, nobody caused them to be blind. That's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How they think is they would ask why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would make a child blind, for example. Why these atrocities happen and things like this. Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow this to happen. The reason why they're asking these questions, because they think of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the same way they think of the human beings. Allah, nothing is the like of Him. So that trail of thinking should be not present to start with. And because many people, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِ, they did not well estimate Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way they ought to. And when they think that they have wisdom to question such a question, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His wisdom is beyond our understanding. So to rely upon the wisdom of Allah. And do we know some of the wisdom of Allah? Of course we do. But again, to rely upon the wisdom of Allah. So whether this is again to establish the reality of this life, that this life is based on tests and trials and good things and bad things, and that people are equally tested, and some people are tested with ease and some people are tested with difficulties, and this is not the life, this is only temporary, right? And everybody shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and for people to be grateful to Allah, for people to worship Allah with patience and so on. But again, the point here is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Almighty and He's the most wise. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, both when they're together, it brings the best of the human being to be righteous and to rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone and to be obedient to Allah. When also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the dua of the believers when they make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. رَبَّنَا لَا تَجْعَلْنَا فِتْنَةً لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَغْفِرْ لَنَا رَبَّنَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. You know, this is a dua when it comes in Surah Al-Mumtahina, when there is the issue of the disbelievers versus the believers, and how the disbelievers, they broke their covenant with the believers, especially with those who are married to them and so on. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Prophet to test the women, those who come from the disbelievers, they embrace Islam and how to deal with their husbands. But the point here is with regards to those who embrace the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the dua, just to take the dua in this verse, that the believers, they ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not to make them fitna or a trial for the disbelievers. وَغْفِرْ لَنَا رَبَّنَا. How can a person be fitna for the disbelievers? In two ways. One of which is when the believers are weak. When the believers are weak, physically weak or poor. That becomes fitna for the disbelievers. Why? Because the disbelievers would say, if these people were upon the truth, why they're weak and poor and so on. So they don't even think about what these believers are upon because they don't want to be like them. So it becomes fitna for the disbelievers. And it's wrong thinking, of course, from a disbeliever to think this way, because who said that being poor and weak, it means that the person is not upon the truth? It's something else. It's like comparing things that are not related to each other. But this is how they become fitna to them. Or to be a fitna for them in the sense that they oppress them and the like of this. So they make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive them. But then they end this dua, إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ وَالْحَكِيمُ. You're the Almighty, the Most Wise. So He's the Almighty, He's able to change the situation, but He's the Most Wise, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So to rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His might and power and His wisdom, subhanahu wa ta'ala, gives patience for the believers. You're a slave of Allah. Worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, be obedient to Allah. Don't be in haste and don't question the wisdom of Allah. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to do something, don't say, but they are acting in such a way. Why this is haram? If this was halal, it would make it easy for us to make da'wah to the people, invite people to the deen of Allah. You know, or let's misinterpret the Quran so that we don't make people upset with us. You know, verses in the Quran that talks about certain things that is halal or haram, or the verses that in the context of fighting for the sake of Allah, let's just change the translation of it or the interpretation of it to please people. This is betraying the trust, concealing the truth, if someone would do such a thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most wise. But many people, the reason why they become, you know, they spread negativity themselves with regards to the deen of Islam, because of their ignorance about the deen of Allah. With knowledge, a person become able to see the great wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And many people, they don't understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so they take things out of context and so on. So that's why we have to refer to the ulama, to the people of knowledge, and to humble ourselves to learn. But having these principles in our hearts, that we believe in the religion of Allah and we convey the truth the way it is in the Quran and in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Azeez Al-Hakeem, the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He's Al-Hakeem. He knows and He's the most wise subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we, as human beings, we are deficient. So that's why we have to refer things and to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with our own understanding and things like this. Many verses, or you know, few surahs in the Quran, that the first verse ends with Al-Azeez Al-Hakeem. Like Surah Az-Zumar, for example. تنزيل من الله العزيز الحكيم, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He revealed this Quran, and He is the Almighty, the Most Wise subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Quran being from Allah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He's the Most Wise subhanahu wa ta'ala, and everything is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is an amazing thing. And how even the surah starts this way. So تنزيل الكتاب من الله العزيز الحكيم, that this Quran, this book of Allah, came down from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Aziz Al-Hakim, the Almighty, the Most Wise. So He's the one that ordained for it to be this way. And He's the Most Wise subhanahu wa ta'ala. So don't question the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Follow the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He subhanahu wa ta'ala is able to do all things. And in the next surah, which is Surah Ghafir, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the dua of the angels to the believers, and how they ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for Allah to accept, to make it easy for the believers to repent and so on. It's a mercy of Allah. And one of which is that the angels, they make dua, and that the angels of their dua is accepted, of course, by Allah. They say, رَبَّنَا وَأَدْخِلُهُمْ جَنَّاتِ عَدْنٍ الَّتِي وَعَدْتَهُمْ وَمَنْ صَلَحَ مِنْ أَبَائِهِمْ وَأَزْوَاجِهِمْ وَذُرِّيَاتِهِمْ إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ, that, O Allah, our Lord, make them enter the gardens underneath which the rivers flow, or the gardens of Eden that you promised them, and those who are upright from their fathers and forefathers and their wives and their offsprings. Indeed, you are the Al-Aziz Al-Hakim. You are the one that is able to do so, and you are the Most Wise. He knows best who fits in Jannah and who is not, who deserves and who does not deserve. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is able to do all things. When a person think about himself, and he would say, how can I be among the people of Jannah when I committed this and this sin? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is able to do all things. He's Al-Aziz subhanahu wa ta'ala. He can change your heart. He can make your heart the most righteous heart. Right? And that's why we should return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and seek help from Allah, because He is Al-Aziz. Al-Izzah, or the might and power, is not just in the physical matters. The hearts are more difficult than the physical things. To change the heart of someone, that's more difficult than doing things physically that needs hundreds of people, of strong men and equipments and technology and power to do. Changing the heart of one person. And who's the one that changes the heart? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The hearts by the control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that means don't rely upon yourself, because you're weak as a human being. We are weak. If we rely upon ourselves to change our hearts, we would fail miserably. But if we rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Aziz, the Almighty, He's the one that changes the heart. That's why the Prophet would say, Allahumma muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deenik. Oh Allah, the change of the hearts, make my heart steadfast on your religion. Because this heart is a mighty thing, it's a difficult thing. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that is able to change the heart. So turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sincerely, seeking that change. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful, and He subhanahu wa ta'ala accept the dua of His slaves. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also in the beginning of Surah Ash-Shura mention Al-Azeez Al-Hakeem, right after Surah Ghafir. It's something that when it's in the beginning of the Surah like this, it brings that attention to the reciter that everything belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Almighty. After Hamim, Ayn, Sin, Qaf, كَذَلِكَ يُوحِي إِلَيْكَ وَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ اللَّهُ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. Who's the one that reveals to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals to you, O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, and those who before you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Azizu al-Hakim, the Almighty, the Most Wise, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He chose the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم to be the final messenger of Allah. And it's not up to anyone. You know, if someone would say, why from among the Arabs, or why from among this or that, why in this part of the world, and things like this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Almighty, the Most Wise, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is by the wisdom of Allah. So that means people, again, they should humble themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is, again, we would see in these verses, and the verses that starts with the tasbih of Allah, and it ends the verse with Al-Aziz al-Hakim. Like in Surah Al-Hadid, سَبَّحَ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. Glory be to Allah. Exalted is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything in the heavens and the earth exalts Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He is the Almighty, the Most Wise. سَبَّحَ لِلَّهِ. Everything makes tasbih. Exalting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything in the heavens and in the earth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Almighty, the Most Wise subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when a surah starts like this, and then when it comes to the orders of Allah mentioned in it, a person would humble himself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's the benefit of knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His names and attributes. Surah Al-Hashr has the same thing. سَبَّحَ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. Exalted is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything exalt Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what's in the heavens and what's in the earth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty, the Most Wise, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then it talks about the people of the book at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and at the end the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So everything is by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Almighty, the Most Wise, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And sometimes it's mentioned in the present tense. يُسَبِّحُ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ الْمَلِكِ الْقُدُّوسِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَكِيمِ. So here Al-Aziz Al-Hakim is mentioned with other names of Allah, that continuously, what's in the heavens and the earth exalts Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and make tasbih to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Malik, the King, Al-Quddus, the one that is the most perfect, Al-Aziz al-Hakim, the Almighty, the Most Wise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, huwa alladhi ba'atha fil ummiyyina rasulan minhum. He's the one that sent to the illiterate ones a messenger from among them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's the one that is able to do all things. And He subhanahu wa ta'ala is able to do all things, and He's the Most Wise subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, again, referring to the power of Allah and to the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's even mentioned in the same surah later on. The Aziz al-Hakim is mentioned again. Like for example, here the first ayah, يُسَبِّحُ اللَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ الْمَلِكِ الْقُدُّوسِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَكِيمِ وَالَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَإِنْ كَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. But the Prophet ﷺ sending a messenger to recite the Quran and to purify them and so on. وَآخَرِينَ مِنْهُمْ لَمَّا يَلْحَقُوا بِهِمْ وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. And others, not just those who the Prophet ﷺ was sent to, others, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Aziz al-Hakim, that He is the Almighty, the Most Wise. So nobody is to decide who is to be guided and who's not, who deserve and who's not. ذَلِكَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ يُؤْتِيهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. This is the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He gives it to whoever He wills. Allah ذُو الْفَضْلِ الْعَظِيمِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that has the exalted fadl and bounty. You know, when people see, for example, someone that is so evil, or they think of him as such an evil person, and they would say there's no way that person would be a Muslim, or there's no way that person would be guided. Who are we to say such a thing? It's called ta'alli ala Allah. You know, there's hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that someone said about his brother. He was a very righteous man from Bani Israel. Someone worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala day and night. And he had a brother that was mischievous and evil and so on. So he said, wallahi la yaghfiru Allahu li fulan. He said, wallahi, Allah would never forgive so and so, such and such. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, man da ladhi yata'alla alayhi. Who's that one that is swearing unto me that I would not forgive him? I forgive him and I make you enter the hellfire. The righteous one enters the hellfire. And the wicked one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive his sins. He's the Almighty. Does that happen without wisdom? Of course, with the wisdom of Allah. He knows best, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let's rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty, the most wise. Think good about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Read the Quran, the way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Be obedient to Allah. Follow the way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And definitely the end of all things will be the best for someone that is upon such righteousness. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to purify our hearts and to make us among those who are steadfast and obedient to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Change your heart, Lord, change our heart. You're living in a lawful way. Be mindful of what you say. Be sincere when you pray. Today could be your last day. Bear each other no malice. Greed and faith can coexist in the same heart. Change your heart.